Mick Gray chats with Jason Faulkner, May 13th, 2022, part one.
Jason, welcome.
Oh man, thanks for having me, Mick. Pleasure.
I've wanted to talk to you for a long time.
Well, I'm happy to talk to you and happy to see everybody here.
You have a good gang. You brought in a bunch of people, a bunch of K-Mick newbies.
Nice.
So, where do we start, man? Well, tell us how'd you get involved in music? How did it start?
I was always really musical when I was from very young. I was sort of playing the piano like this, before I could read. It started with piano because that's the only instrument we had in the house. And then my mom enrolled my sister my sister's 2.5 years older, a little less than 2.5 years older. She enrolled her in a little beginning music course with a bunch of kids in a room on these cool little keyboards. I wish I had one of these keyboards, but the teacher would say something or play a little very simple motif, and the kids would have to all do that in unison. And my mom brought me one day. This is a story my mom tells me because I have no memory of this, but she brought me and I was sitting on her lap, or she was holding me basically, and I started harmonizing with the unison notes that everybody's playing. I'm just playing the harmony notes.
Wow.
And leaving my mom, the teacher pulled my mom aside and said, obviously this is your son. He kind of needs to be in this class more than
class. You had something natural within you happening there, it sounds like.
Or very unnatural.
It was just there, man. It was just there.
Yeah. And then I did that course for a couple of months or something. And then a teacher was brought in, and I studied with this teacher from five to six or seven. And at that point, the teacher said that I had outgrown her curriculum.
Oh my God.
I'm not saying that I was playing Rachmaninoff, but I was definitely, she was a children's piano teacher.
Yeah.
That was going to prepare me for maybe a life as a concert pianist. So that was really what my parents thought my calling was. And much to their dismay, that's not what I did.
Well, now you got me sucked into this story. Go on. Now what happened after that?
Well, so then I went with I was basically brought in by the kind of Madame Suzatska, if you will, of my neighborhood out in the suburbs of LA. This highly respected, badass, very intimidating woman, and she kicked my ass every week at lessons. And if I didn't do the work, she knew I didn't do the work, and I never did the work. So I was. I was a very good I would cram like the day of my lesson. That whole day of school, I think it was Wednesdays, was just terror, just murder day. Because I'm like, she's going to kick my ass again. And I don't really like my ass kicked. So I would be nervous, knot in my stomach all day. And then I would come home and I would just cram all this stuff that I was supposed to have done during the week. And I could fool her sometimes, but she was really, but in a great way, and basically bred champions and her thing. So I quit. I did that all the way up until 16.
Oh my God, with her?
With her.
Oh my God.
And it was you are the great hope of her roster.
Holy crap.
I already know. I knew people at Juilliard. We're not talking about Berkeley. We're talking about Juilliard. And she's like, I can, you will be able to get into Juilliard as a pianist. And I was like, and I just was like, I discovered all this weird music that I liked. I mean, I grew up on classic sort of FM rock stuff like Boston and Led Zeppelin and of course the Beatles and Stevie, all the stuff that was on the radio in the 70s when I was a kid. But I started getting into, I met a friend who had all this weird British stuff. and I started getting into all this kind of like post-punk stuff.
Yeah.
And that created a chasm or schism. I never know which one's right.
It just messed you up is what it did.
Completely. It took me off of this path that wasn't even really my own path with the classical music. So it basically confirmed that I need to do something else. And also, it must be noted that I had been begging for an electric guitar from about age 11. And my parents knew that the guitar was the devil, and they knew it was going to take. Because the electric guitar is the devil.
It's true.
It's a sexy little tool, and it creates monsters.
Satan laughs in the back room of all guitar stores, right? Yeah. take it.
So I had been asking for that for years. I didn't get one until I think I was 13. I think I was asking for one as early as 9 or 10. And I finally got an electric guitar. So that, in addition to this new knowledge I had of all this weird music that was just blew my mind, you know, like bands like Magazine and Wire, and all that stuff. I really, really got into all that kind of post-punk, like Jagged stuff. And because it didn't even sound like music to me. It was like a totally different expression, but I liked that expression so much. I thought it was very authentic and tough. And so those two things in concert derailed me from classical. Thank God. You know what? Because classical pianists have, I think, the second highest suicide rate next to maybe Chinese students.
Oh, no, man. Are you kidding me, man? Classical, you would think music, you know, the slogan of K-Mic is music heals. You know, it's not supposed to.
Not an interpreter of the greats.
No. Does it have to do with, you think, that classical pianists are striving for perfection so intensely, and you'll never capture it, really?
Well, I think it's that, but I also think, like, if you're creative at all, the only creativity you're afforded if you're a concert pianist is just in your interpretation. You can't add anything to that music,
and you don't really write new classical music very often. It's a very small amount of people that do that, right?
You would be stoned to death if you changed anything in that music. So the interpretation is really your only creativity, and for me that wasn't enough.
And you could probably get in trouble for interpreting it too drastic, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's very rigid.
I never thought about it that way. God,
I'm not a rigid guy at all. I'm like extremely, seat of the pants, rubber bands and glue, and I'm just like not.
I don't
be too organized, you know. If y'all got a peek inside this house right here, which you won't, it's a fucking mess.
Now, I'm going to jump out of order, because this is K-Mic Radio and it doesn't give a fuck what, I don't give a shit what I do around here. We're just having fun. But this week, when I emailed you, you said you were working on a horror movie soundtrack. Can you tell us anything about that?
Yeah, it's my friend's movie. It's called The Stay. I don't know when it's going to come out, but it's kind of a Shining-esque. It's just Shining-esque in that it takes place in an abandoned.
Ooh.
But it's a hotel that one of the protagonists has inherited.
Yeah.
But it's fun. I mean, I had this idea very early on, like when she first approached me to do this. Where I wanted to have I'm getting killed by mosquitoes. Just like sounds, like sort of electrical hums and generator sounds as kind of a main base for everything. So that's kind of like the thread throughout all the music I've done. It's just kind of like this grating thing, which is super fun for me to do this, because I've never, you know, normally I'm not trying to upset people with my music.
I was just gonna say, you've done other soundtrack stuff, but this has to be, you have to, like, I mean, you think about like the kind of thing. You gotta poke people with your music.
Yeah. Make them uncomfortable, exactly.
And are you having fun doing that?
Oh my God, it's so much fun. I love it.
That's fantastic, man. That is fantastic. Well, let's get back on track here. You probably had other bands. Your parents were pissed at you. What are you doing rock and roll for? God damn it. But then you meet up with guys and that have already started a band, the 3 o'clock. That's one of the first bands you get noticed in.
Yeah. Yeah. The 3 o'clock happened because I had just come home from, I'd worked in a cannery in Alaska, right out of high school. And my friends and I drove up there and they all left before I did. And I stayed till the bitter end when it turned into full on Mad Max. It was terrifying because the locals started coming into the camps where we were, all the college kids and like young professors were up there doing this because we all love Steinbeck and Hemingway. Uh-huh. And they're like, these pussy, you know, we're like, let's scare these guys. And so these guys would come in dirt bikes and like rip apart your tent with their back wheel. And
what?
It turned into absolute bedlam. So I fled Kenai, Alaska. I fled like just barely with my life. And I came back. During my time in Alaska, I was there for like 3 months. And during my time in Alaska, I was like, man, I have to get a band together. But see, I was already like a band leader. I was already the singer and the writer in my mind. So, So when I came back, I put an ad out in the paper that said something to the effect of, singer-songwriter, multi-instrumentalist looking for like-minded individuals. And the funny thing is, in my ad, I put, you had to put some influences, even though I hate doing that. But I said like Bowie, XTC, and the Blue Nile, right?
Whoa.
Very disparate things. I got one phone call, and it was Roger Manning. So I met Roger, and he came over to my parents' house where I was living, and we played some of our songs on the piano that I had. And he was like, man, I love your songs, and we got to do something sometime. And fast forward like maybe 6 months, I'm looking at the recycler because I looked at it all the time. I bought a bunch of gear on the recycler, and I see in band seeking musicians, I see 3 o'clock looking for guitar player. And I'm like, so when I was in high school, my high school band covered 2 3 o'clock songs.
Wow. So you knew them.
Oh no. I was a gushing fan. I'd seen the 3 o'clock probably 5 times.
Too cool.
16 years old.
Yeah.
This was a no brainer. But I'd kind of forgotten about them. So I called the number, and it was Danny Bonaire, the drummer, who was also in the Quick before that.
Yeah.
I talked to Danny for, I think our first conversation was like two hours long. Wow. And we just totally got along, and I ended up in that band. And the tragedy for me was musical, because I didn't really like where they had gone since I had paid attention last. And the new stuff was like, kind of sounded like they were trying to kind of keep up with the Joneses a little bit, or like stay current, when they came, they were born out of this kind of like 60s Monkees thing.
Right.
And with the whole LA Paisley Underground thing, which they were, they were kings of.
Right. Right. So, and this record Vermilion, it sounds quite a bit different than their stuff that they did before. Right?
Yeah. I was not a fan of that record. I was the guy kicking and screaming in the studio, like, guys, like, you're like a great, like, kind of psychedelic pop band. Like, what is this garbage? And I was the, like, the little kid. I was the new kid. I was 18 years old. And they were like, not interested in your opinion, dude.
And Prince was somehow peripherally involved. Did you ever get to meet him?
I did meet him. Well, he signed the band because, as the legend goes, he and Susanna Hoffs were friends, and the Bangles had covered that song of his. And he basically said, like, what else is going on in LA? Like Bangles are great. What else is going on? And Susanna, being the cool person she is, said, well, the coolest band in LA is the 3 o'clock. Yeah. So that's behind us. It was because of Susanna Hoffs.
Wow.
I did meet him. So when we were making the record, we kept getting these phone calls. Like, we'd get these phone calls, I don't know, 5 times, where it was like, Prince is en route. He's coming down. He's at LAX, stepping into a limo. He's coming to see you guys. make sure you have no friends, no family, nobody there except the band. He doesn't want anybody. He doesn't want to talk to anybody. So, you know, we never had anybody there anyway. So that was easy. but he was always a no-show. So,
wow. And this happened multiple times and he never showed up?
This happened at least four times. Oh, at least four times where we're all excited that we're going to finally meet.
That's totally Prince. Yeah.
So then the only time I did meet him, I was, he flew all of the Paisley Park artists out to Minneapolis to see the first show of the Love Sexy tour.
Wow. And
I remember I was standing with Jill Jones, who is, I don't know if you know who that is, but yeah. That's the girl in the blonde wig with the fishnet stockings in the Little Red Corvette video.
Yeah.
She's with Lisa Coleman on keyboards. And so I'm talking to her and I was very excited about that. Like that was plenty for me. And then I saw this little, this was at the after party. He played a 3-hour show, right? Had the Thunderbird on stage for, Alphabet Street or whatever. And afterward, we're all shuttled to Paisley Park. And he does like another 3-hour jam session with George Clinton, everybody. I mean, on the plane there, George Clinton barred my Spin magazine. Chaka Khan breastfeeding right behind me. It was like, there's a LAPD right here.
Look out. It's not you.
Yes, yeah, not. And so anyway, so I see this, Jill and I are standing in this area and I see this like little hole in the crowd. After they'd played, there was like a little donut hole, I call it. And it stopped and then it would move a little bit, stop and zigzag a little bit. And it's kind of making its way over towards where we're standing. And we're like a few steps up from that. So that's how I can see it. And I said to Jill, I'm like, I bet Prince is in the middle of that little hole. Cause I think that's why it keeps stopping and moving. Yeah. Cause everybody's giving him a little bit of space, but you can't see him cause he's a little guy. And it keeps coming over closer and closer. And it finally, I swear to God, it parts and it's like biblical. And he's also got like, somehow he has like special lighting on him. So like he's illuminated in a different way than everybody else.
God.
He comes up and he walks up the steps. And he's like, hey, Jill. And they do the double kiss. And then she goes, Jill, this is Jason. He goes, I know who he is. And he goes, you're a great guitar player. And I'm like, and he said that to me and I literally bit my lip from saying like, oh man, I wish you could hear me actually play. Judging from that clunker.
Unbelievable, man. Unbelievable.
That was the only time I ever met him.
It's like every story you hear about him, you go, it's so weird, but yet you go, oh, that's totally Prince. It just seems like he just lived this life that he moved like that through crowds and
he has some special energy.
There was really a special mojo there, man. Love Has No Heart from the 1988 release from the 3 o'clock. What do you think here? How long has it been since you heard that, Jason?
That was almost cruel.
I'm sorry. I'm so bad at Jason Faulkner, this is your life. I'm like that TV show on KMAC like, all the time.
Part of my life. No, I haven't listened to that in probably 20 years.
It's a pretty cool song. It's a lot different than the rest of that record. I tell you that.
You know what? Just listening to it just then, I finally recognized why my dear friend Jeremy Stacey, the gnarly drummer that's in King Crimson right now, who used to be my drummer a long time ago, said like, there's something about you that's kind of like John Wetton, and I just heard it in that song.
I can hear that too now that you say that.
It's that
song.
Like especially UK John Wetton,
right?
Not Asia.
No. Yeah. Oh. I love it, man. That's pretty cool to hear. I liked it a lot. So that band just kind of extinguishes pretty much right after that album.
Yeah, I mean, they've been around for so long, a good amount of years, and we just imploded.
Yeah,
I quit, and then they just were like, we're done. So
yeah, and how long before you hey, That guy that I met a while ago.
Oh, yeah. So right when I joined the 3 o'clock, Roger had called me, and that was probably a year or a little less than a year after we had first met. And he said he was moving back to San Francisco to start a band with like a guy that he'd known since they were kids. And they had a band, but they wanted to, he was like, you're the guitar player. You want to be, you're perfect. And I was like, dude, I just joined at 3 o'clock. And so we both, did high fives over the phone and cracked up about that. And then on that ill-fated 3 o'clock tour, which was probably only about 4 months, one of the shows in San Jose, I think it was. I remember we were in San Francisco and they were playing the Beatnik Beach record and I didn't think anything of it. But I think I remember that I didn't even know that was the band that Roger had called me 6 months earlier to join. And we are playing in a club in San Jose and the guitar player of the opening band comes up like right after their sound check and he's like, hey, I think you know our keyboard player. I'm like, who's your keyboard player? He's like, Roger Manning. And I'm like, I don't really know him, but yeah, Roger. And also Roger comes walking up to me and now he looks totally different. He's got like dreadlocks and he's like,
yeah,
think of him as a sea monster. And he's like, this is the band. So not this band, but it's my idea is that it's you and me and that and this guy that's playing drums singing. You'll see him. And I was like, oh, okay. He's like, if you could watch our show, please watch it. So I watched their show and I was utterly floored by Andy.
Wow.
He was great. And I didn't like a lot of the songs, but I liked Andy's voice and I liked his drumming and I just liked it. Right. So that was the beginning of the Olivers, basically. I knew I was going to, I was miserable in 3 o'clock. So I knew that was going to be short lived. So I think when I got home, this is back when there's no cell phone. So you have to call on the the kitchen. And I'm like, I left at 3 o'clock and, and he's like, oh man, well, what we should do, because he did have some. He had some idea that maybe Andy and I would have some friction because we're both extremely alpha. Like for real, like it could be a problem.
Yikes, yikes.
There usually can't be that two? Much of that in a band. And so when we met, I would say that Andy was on his best behavior. And I learned later that was his best behavior. Wow. So yeah, that was interesting. But yeah, that's how it all started.
How long were you guys together again?
How long was Jellyfish together?
Yeah.
Well, I left after the first album. We did like a year of touring. That was so that we made the record in '89, came out in '90, and I left at the end of '91.
Yeah. And they went on. They had a couple more records after that, didn't they?
One more.
Yeah.
Just two records total.
Right. K-Mac Radio with Jellyfish with That Is Why. I love that song.
Yeah, thanks, man.
It's a beauty. You were a great addition to that pack of reggae mop heads.
Yeah, that was, I feel like if that band could have gone, if Andy and I could have sort of just communicated, or I should say if he could have communicated, we probably would have done a lot more.
Yeah.
It made more of an impact. Because I thought he was a brilliant guy and I know he felt the same way about me and we just couldn't get together, man. We didn't even talk on the road.
God.
It was a really dysfunctional.
Yeah. I mean, when I see live recordings of you guys, it's just so powerful and so happening, man. I never got to see you live.
Yeah. Yeah, we were good live. I mean, we rehearsed our asses off. And also, Chris, the bass player, who's Roger's brother, because I'm the main bass player on the record. I'm playing on that last song, mm-hmm. Bass and guitar. But, Chris wasn't really like, he was playing the bass before he was in the band, but he wasn't really like, didn't have a lot of experience and wasn't that, advanced on the instrument, and I basically was tasked with kind of like bringing him up to speed, which took like, I mean, I spent like months with the guy, like every day, drive, like, you know, taking Bart to Oakland and whatever, and just, you know,
working him with him.
And it was just, it was a lot. There was a lot of work. I mean, we all had like a really gnarly work ethic. So.
God, that's crazy, man. Now you meet another amazing musician, John Bryan, and you form a one-off album band called The Grays. No relation to me, but spelled the same way as my name.
That's right.
How'd that happen?
So when I was in Jellyfish, I had a girlfriend that worked in a coffee house here in LA, and I used to make her mixtapes, and I made her a mixtape that had like Odyssey and Oracle, the Village Green Preservation Society, Emmett Rhodes, I think Colin Blundstone's 1 Year was on there.
God, and, great records.
And she used to play that at work. And when I came home from tour, one of the legs, she's like, oh, there's this weird guy that's like always hanging out, and he's got a book, but it's upside down. I don't even think he's reading it. I think he's just kind of but she said he came bounding up her one day when she was playing that tape and was like, you know, who's playing this music? And she said, oh, my boyfriend Jason made it. And he's like, who's your boyfriend? She said my name, and I guess he knew who I was and stuff. And he came back the next day with like a cassette to give to her of some other things. Like he had like Ray Davies demos and stuff. And then also some of his own music. And I remember liking a lot of his own music. I didn't love everything about it, but I felt a kindred spirit in some of what he was doing. And so we basically, you know, again, pre-cell phone, you know, called cord on the swiggly cord kitchen phone, and made a little rock date. And he came over, and we went out drinking, and we drank until we couldn't drink anymore, and we just became kind of friends in that way first. But it was a bit of like, you know, like looking at each other like this, like we're kind of the same but also very different. And so I never intended on the Grace thing. Was a total lark. Like it was a total mistake.
Yeah.
Because what happened was I had a new girlfriend. There's always something in that department. I was living with her, and I was recording a bunch of demos. I bought a Toys R Us kids drum kit, making all these demos. Making all these recordings and writing all these songs right after I quit Jellyfish. And John calls me up one day, and he's like, hey man, it's probably been a long time since you've been in a room with other musicians. You should come down. I have some friends who just moved out from Boston, and like we're already at this rehearsal place right down the street from you. Just come down and let's just play like some Kink songs and goof around. And it sounded like a good idea at the time. So I went down there, and the other guys were Buddy and Dan. And it was just kind of this thing where we're just jamming and having fun and just meeting each other and like, oh wow, we all know that song, how cool, like wow, we sound pretty good playing that song, like what are the odds of that? And unbeknownst to me, they had a friend that I later became friends with, this guy Manny, who was loitering at the same rehearsal studio, and he called this A&R guy at Capitol, this guy named Josh Deutsch, who I had already been in contact with because my lawyer was trying to find me a solo record deal right after Jellyfish. And Josh Deutsch was one of the people that my lawyer had sent my cassette to. So this guy calls Josh Deutsch and says, you're not going to believe it, but I'm witnessing the beginning of a fucking band of like Jason Fogner, John Bryan, Dan Carroll. They're a band. And I didn't even know this phone call happened. It was made from phone in the lobby of the rehearsal studio. And I get home that night to a message from Josh Deutsch saying, I will sign this sight unseen. Which, that doesn't happen.
No.
It's just that I had a lot of, there was a lot of people wondering what I was going to do next, especially in Los Angeles at that time after leaving Jellyfish. And there was a lot of intrigue as to what my next thing was going to be.
And John Bryan wasn't really known of at that point?
John Bryan was only known as a guy that had worked on the last Till Tuesday record.
Holy crap, man.
I believe that at least John, maybe even a couple of those other guys, had the same message from Josh Deutsch on rehearsal from jamming. We weren't rehearsing, we were in a band. And
that's insane. It was a beautiful mistake, though. It really, I mean, the record is cohesive.
The record is cohesive for a few reasons. I mean, the reality of the situation is that I was so tired of being under the thumb of anybody, and I was really under the thumb of Andy and Roger and Jellyfish. So, you know, I was bursting at the seams musically and also, you know, ego. I was just like, I know what's up, and I know the best way to do stuff.
Did it seem like at that moment you felt almost like I'm just getting back into another situation like I was in?
Yeah, but what happened is I really took over the Grays.
Ah.
So the Grays record is like kind of, I don't want to be arrogant or anything or like say that I'm taking all the credit, because I'm not. But sound of that record is Jack Quinn, who's a brilliant engineer, who I brought in from Jellyfish.
Yeah.
And then kind of like the focus of it was where I was at, because John wanted to make a very different record. He wanted to make a more like ramshackle, like loose. And I love that stuff. Trust me. And I wanted to do that as well. And I wanted to have that represented on that record. And the way we recorded it was very ramshackle and loose. I mean, we were eating mescaline and stuff, and like, we were like doing it right.
Yeah.
But because of Jack's, you know, like pristine ear and talent of mixing, and also just the sound, I remember playing him like Big Star's first record, and he was like, "You like this? You like the sound of this?" And I'm like, "Yes." And it was like, he's like, "Well, it's got reverb on the drums." And I'm like, "Yeah." but like in 1993, reverb on the drums was extremely unfashionable.
Wow.
You know, the dry, dead drum sound was what was happening. And that was also like something I was really into as well, because of like all the 70s rock stuff that I like Steely Dan. Steely Dan Asian sound is just, forget about it. Yeah. So,
I do sort of, I don't know what it is, but I hear some Big Star in the Grays record.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's all stuff that is aspiring to write the best song that no one's ever heard. I mean, I think that's what they were doing. I think that's what the Beatles were doing. I think that's, I think that's what, you know, all the good guitar rock band, pop bands, whatever you want to call it. I hate the word pop, but you know,
why? Why do you hate the word pop?
Just because of what it means now.
Now, because pop became something that it doesn't, it never meant before. It is weird now.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, so that's how that band happened. And that's also why the band couldn't survive. I mean, we didn't have our first meetings when we were like, when we're getting all this attention and all these like people saying, "We'll sign this," you know, without even seeing you guys. And I remember we'd go to this bar and we'd all sit and talk, and we're like, "All right, we came up with this concept okay, so there's not going to be any leader of this band. It's going to be four generals."
That's tough.
Well, exactly. that's deeply flawed.
You guys tour?
Yeah. We opened for we toured with the Smithereens for like a month.
Ah, cool.
We toured on our own for about 6 months.
God, I wish I would have seen you.
Yeah, our shows were loose and weird. I remember we played like a Hard Rock Cafe, and John and I were instruments off the wall and plugging them in and playing.
Oh like, my God.
Fucking Tony Iommi's guitar.
Cool. Jimmy Page's guitar. Awesome. Yeah. Oh, that must have been fun.
Yeah.
I had to throw the magazine cover in there because when I was listening to Miracle Medicine, I was going, gosh, I almost hear some kind of magazine influence on Miracle Medicine there.
Well, that's actually really funny that you say that because if anything on that song is a direct nod to somebody, it's my drumming, which is a direct nod to John Mayer, not the John Mayer we all know. The original drummer of the Buzzcocks' name is John Mayer.
Wow.
He did this thing. It always had these like these syncopations.
Yeah.
Doing that on that track, instead of just playing it straight, it's like it's got all this crazy shit in it. And that was my my nod to and the reason that's crazy is because the original sync of the Buzzcocks was Howard DeBoto.
The roundabout connections there. We made it. We made the full circle there. I mean, you know what? My first interview I ever did, and I don't think I even have a copy of it, was Howard DeBoto.
Are you serious?
I interviewed Howard DeBoto in a tiny little club called One Step Beyond in Santa Clara, California. When he came through doing his solo, his first solo record at that time.
Like Luxuria?
Yeah. No, before Luxuria.
Oh, before Luxuria. Yeah. Was he kind or was he difficult?
He was kind. I mean, especially for somebody who was like nervous as all fuck.
Yeah.
And I sit down backstage with him and he was really, he was great with me. He was great.
I bore Howard DeBoto.
Oh man, that, you know, that whole the spiral scratch record, and then, you know, and then what happened with Magazine. Oh my God.
Yeah, Daylight for me is still something. I mean, I remember like 15 years old going to visit my grandma in Missouri, and I was like, we're driving around in her like Nissan Sentra, and I'm playing like Magazine Secondhand Daylight. My poor grandma, I don't understand this music. And I'm like, yeah, neither do I, but it's great.
We do concept shows on KMIC Radio all the time, and that's one that's in the works. It's got to happen soon. Is a Howard DeBoto, 4 hours of Howard DeBoto. We can do it.
Sign me up.
That record, your first solo record, presents Author Unknown. It's just a gem all the way through. I love everything. You can hear in What's Happening with the Grays that you were like, I got to do the solo record.
Yes. No, that's, I appreciate that. It's it's very much the sound of a 26-year-old exploding at the seams.
Coming unglued. all over the studio. Yeah. Pretty amazing.
I used it myself and to play every instrument for the first time. And I was just, you know, and I did some things on that record I'm still very proud of, but I mean, a lot of that record, I was kind of making it almost intentionally and not necessarily taking you, the listener, exactly where you think it should go, or even where as a writer, where it probably should go. Like I was very, there's kind of an antagonism in that period for me that was like, I'm going to make the casual observer, I'm going to scare the casual observer away, and I'm going to people who are like really, really into this because my motivation was to stretch things out and expand on this genre, whatever you want to fucking call it. But just, I wanted it to be something unexpected. And I mean, I still have that in me, but I think in later years, I became much more interested in like the, not that I ever have ever even approached anything country, but I like the concept of like the country, like the Glenn Campbells and Parks and the Patsy Clines that are singing to the camera and just pleading their case. And that the antithesis of that first solo record. That first solo record is a veiled sort of a prankster, really, if you will. Like I just kind of like I just wanted to stir it up and like not ever give anybody exactly what they're expecting. And I've gotten that, that's ingrained in me. That's part of me. That's,
yeah. Nobody, I think that's you. That's you. And that's what I love about you.
Yeah, nobody taught me that. I can't lose that. But I think now I'm like, when you all hear my new record, it's way more direct.
When's the new thing supposed to come out?
I have no idea, man. I have no idea. I'm talking to.
I think I asked you that a year and a half ago, Jason. When's a new record coming out?
Well, a year and a half ago, it wasn't done.
It's
really almost done.
Okay.
Wow. I am very, very busy doing.
I know you are. You are going. You go crazy, man. We got to get into that. We got to get into the session player. You play with freaking everybody.
I played a lot of stuff. I mean, I say no to more than I say yes, but the things I've said yes to are things that mattered to me. So,
yeah.
But like, yeah, I mean, I'm just slammed, but I'm trying to get this record done. And, you know, I miss the good old days where I had a label that was like calling me going, where's the record?
Yeah.
You know, because
it's a different world. The recording industry is completely.
Yeah. I work well with that pressure.
Yeah.
And if I don't have any pressure from anybody, as we all know, it's been 12 years since my last record.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It is crazy. I do want to play. All of a sudden, when you said that, I was getting ready to go into the session stuff. But TV Eyes.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about TV Eyes?
Yeah, TV Eyes is something I'm super proud of. I mean,
I love it. I love it.
I love that record so much. I've listened to that many times during quarantine, having these on my porch, my famous margaritas.
yes.
And
mix me one.
I point out that I'm getting absolutely murdered by
mosquitoes. Oh, why don't you go in? You're getting eaten by mosquitoes. God, I'd be swelling up all over the place if I were you.
Mosquito bites on my fingers. Not to and that's not even any good juice there. Like somebody needs to tell the mosquito on your finger.
You need one of those bug zappers, man. Well, that hangs, catches them all.
Well, I have this, which, by the way, I would like Thermacell to.
It's not working. It's not working.
Well, no, I left it and the last of the juice.
Oh, the juice is gone.
So that's why I'm getting murdered. But TBIs was so that happened because. Brian Reitzel, the drummer from Red Cross, and then later we were with an air at the same time. And Roger and I, Brian and Roger had done this phony soundtrack, non-existent sequel to Logan. Okay.
Yeah.
And Logan Sanctuary. And they had me come in and sing some like crooner, like girl, kind of Scott Walker, Tom Jones kind of thing. But like porno version. And I was also playing like some crazy like 70s shreddy, like not too shreddy because I can't do that, but like 70s shreddy guitar. And we finished that recording date and we all just in the parking lot saying goodbye, and we were like, man, this was fun, we should do something. And then we all just started riffing, just like, oh man, like Two Boy Army and like, you know, Heaven 17 and
John Fox.
John, exactly, early
on. It's ultra. Cold. It has that cold grab, you know, grabs you.
Very, very well noted, my friend. Good, good call on the John Fox. Yeah, I'm an early Ultra Fox fanatic.
Yeah. And
so we started coming up with these little bits of songs. But like Brian and I were in air at the same time, so we were really busy. I mean, we toured the world, and so we would record this record kind of in between that stuff. And you know what happened was like we had these riffs, like mainly like kind of like dark synth riffs and stuff, and I realized that if it didn't get more serious, if somebody didn't take this more seriously and like make it more art. then it was going to be just kind of like another joke record. And I'm not interested in making joke records at all.
It could have been a parody. Yeah, it could have been a parody. A lot of people make those kind of 80s rock records that are parodies.
I judge that. So I was like, no, I'm going to go and hide out, and I'm going to write this dystopian nightmare or blues thing. And that's what I did. And all of those songs, there's some, I've always got to have some love songs, especially the unrequited ones.
Yeah.
But there's a huge amount of paranoia and unsettled dystopian nightmare I really, really am proud of.
It has to have that.
Yeah. And that's something I've never delved in on my own, because that's not how I operate. But yeah, like in the context of that music that we were creating, I was like, no, this is not, I'm not going to write about, driving a car or getting along with somebody. I'm going to write about some sort of corporation that has us, over its knee, spanking us to death.
Hey, Fake Records of Rock and Roll off of Daniel Johnston's little record he put out there with you producing.
Yeah, I'm playing every instrument.
That's a freaking crazy, that's a different turn for Daniel. Totally different.
Yeah, that was crazy.
How did that happen?
Well, so his manager, Tom, was somebody that wanted to manage me years earlier, and I had gone with a different management company that went bust. But Tom called me one day and he was like, I have this weird idea that you should do your, what if you did your one-man band thing to Daniel?
Oh, geez.
And I initially said, absolutely not, because I'm hyper aware of his fans and his sort of legacy at that point, and the fact that he is, somebody who's never really made a wildly produced record.
Yeah, it's always totally underproduced.
Underproduced, yeah, and just very raw and all that. And I love that about him, but I was just like, I'm not the right guy. So at least I had that wherewithal, but I thought about it that night, and then the next day I was like, maybe it is a good idea. Maybe, yeah. He goes, let's just do this. Why don't I come out? His brother, Dick, who is just the sweetest guy in the world, Daniel's brother, was kind of his minder, because Daniel was pretty sick.
He had a tough time, yeah.
So Tom was like, I think you guys should just meet, and it won't be any fault of yours, but he might think you're a demon. So I want to make sure.
Oh, no. That's a bad way to go into a meeting.
Actually schizophrenic.
I know. Well, if anybody had seen the documentary about him, he crashed a plane with his dad because he thought there was a demon in the plane.
Yeah, exactly. And he said, it wouldn't be because you are or anything, obviously, but just before we commit to this, why don't we have a little meeting, see how that goes. So I went and I picked a place in LA. They flew out to LA, and I met them, and I walked into this cafe, and I was like, and I see Daniel, and I walk up and I sit down, and everybody's friendly, but Daniel's like, so you're the producer? And I'm like, well, sometimes I'm a producer. I don't know if I'm the producer, Martin. But and he goes, oh, well, I heard you played the Beatles. And I was like, or you played the Paul McCartney. And I was like, yeah, I played Paul McCartney. And
That does it for Daniel right there.
That was it. He's like, what was that like? And I was like, well, it was more than you can imagine. And you can probably imagine a lot. So it was incredible. And we had a nice lunch. And then we all decided to go back to my place, which was micro. I had a little tiny place in Hollywood at the time. And Daniel chain smoked and drank all Snapple. So we went to the Gelson's down the street from the place where we had met and had lunch. And we bought a case of Snapple and a carton of cigarettes. And we sat in my room, in my little studio, and I just pressed record. And and he was playing a bunch of stuff on his nylon string guitar. And they would all start like, my back is to him.
Yeah.
And they would all start like, oh man, this is just like life changing right here. This is so good. And then they would just devolve into total madness. Yeah. And non sequitur, never going back, never repeating what should be repeated and all this stuff.
Wow. What year was this? How long was this before he passed?
I don't remember exactly when that year came out, when that record came out, but this is like 10 years ago.
Okay.
So I'm recording this stuff and he's just like, I got another one. He's got a bulging notebook of lyrics and drawings. It's just so cool.
Oh, his art.
He's going through and he's like, oh, how about this one? And he's playing. And they're just like getting more and more like, it's just like, I mean, let's put it this way. I have an amazing experimental record of just him playing these songs that really don't have any rhyme or reason or don't have any form.
Wow. That
probably really like, but I was sort of tasked to turn these really crude ideas into songs. So we did that for 2 days and then he went away and I made the record by myself.
God.
He's on the record very, very little. I even did some nylon string guitar and tried to kind of play it not as succinctly as I would.
Yeah.
And just to sort of try and sound like Daniel. He's not playing much on the record, but he's singing everything.
Yeah, insane. I mean, that song, Fake Records of Rock and Roll, just like, it just hums, man. I mean, it's great.
You know what's funny about that song is when we recorded that, because I love songs about like, I love songs like, you know, flipping off like shitty bands that suck and all that stuff. So that's kind of what I'm talking about. I only later found out because his brother Dick told me that no, it's about the original master recording series records.
Oh.
He's like, they sound just like the other record, like, and people don't know, like the fake records of rock and roll.
So just because it has the original master recordings label across the top, he thought that was nothing.
It's all about those audiophile series releases. They're like three times the amount of money.
Daniel Johnston would not be into audiophile. Just no way he'd be into that.
No. Yeah, so that was really cool. And you know what, like the greatest thing for me is when I work with somebody, especially in that capacity, and especially somebody that was that, troubled, but amazing. You never know what they're gonna think, you know. So like when I handed the record in to his management, I think I even kind of dodged some calls back because I was like, oh shit, like I don't know if they're gonna like this. And I was, like I said, I was hyper aware of his fans. And I'm like, is this too slick or is this too me or blah, blah, blah. And I really tried not to make it too me. I really labored over it.
Yeah. What was his reaction? What was his reaction?
His favorite record that he ever made.
Oh man, that must have made you feel so good.
Yeah. And he told me that every time I saw him until he passed, and it was really special. He would call it he's like, I love your record. I'm like, it's not my record, Daniel, it's your record.
Damn.
He's like, but you made me sound like the Beatles.
Shit.
Which is like all he ever wanted. He's like, it sounds like the Beatles.
That's all he cared about.
Like, Daniel, man, he was the sweetest guy. I loved Daniel. I was very, very sad when he passed.
Jeez, yeah. I got to meet him once. I always tell the story in Austin, Texas at one of his art shows. And I'm a comic book artist, and I went up to him, and he had this big old group of, you know, groupies all hanging around him. And I was just like, kind of walked up and went, hi, Daniel, I'm Mick Gray. I work for DC Comics. And he went, oh my God, you work for DC Comics. And all of his friends like backed off, and they were looking at me like they were pissed at me because I took the, you know, attention away from them.
Exactly.
Oh, but at least I got to meet him.
Well, I didn't know you worked for DC Comics. That's pretty damn cool.
Well, I'll have to send you some comics, Jason.
Well,
you're a comic fan?
Not a huge, but I do appreciate the medium.
I'll send you some stuff.
All right, cool.
As a thank you. Another guy that you worked with that has a reputation. I don't know. I've only met this guy once, and he's a little different. But you've recorded two albums with Mr. R. Stevie Moore, one of the premier original DIY recorders in rock and roll history.
Yes. Oh, he's Stevie is my favorite living human.
He's something.
Yeah, he's so prolific and so like achingly unique and just like a total hero. I love that man to his core, and he feels the same way, which is really.
Do you have a favorite song off of one of the records you did?
Off the one we did.
Well, you did two with him, right? You did Ku Klux Glam and Another Day.
So the first one, the tragically titled one, that was basically him and Ariel Pink, who's an old friend of mine, uh-huh. And. We did like three songs together, Come My Way, Dutch Me, and No Zipper. We did those independently of pretty much the rest of that record.
Ah.
The record that Stevie and I did together is Make It Be.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah. So off Make It Be, are you going to play something off that?
I think I can find it. Hold on.
Or if you have the other one,
I have Another Day slips.
Yeah, that's a good one. So that's an old song of his. So the whole concept for that record was that we were going to revisit a lot of his back catalog and kind of like reimagine it.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a song of his from a record I'd never heard, sort of from the early 90s.
Huh.
And
much material.
He has 300 albums. 300 plus albums, but not all of them were released in physical form, but he literally has 300 albums worth of music.
That's insane.
300.
It's hard to even fathom that.
Yeah. Yeah. But that song, Another Day Slips Away, was something because he was leaving. We were basically finished with everything we had done. We made that whole record in 2 weeks.
Jeez.
He had to go back home, you know, because there's nobody paying us to do this.
Yeah.
And like the last night he was at my house, he's like, "Hey, would you want to like just do like your own like just a Jason Faulkner version of this Another Day Slips Away?" So Another Day Slips Away is me on every single thing.
Oh wow!
He's not on that.
He's not even on this.
But it's his song.
But it's his song. Wow, those are great. I play myself some music. It's just. I don't know, since I heard him do that the first time, I was just blown away by that recording.
It's such amazing. Yeah, no, I'm like a gushing fan of Stevie's.
Yeah, and that was recorded in the early 80s, right?
The original Play Myself Some Music, I believe, yeah, it's very early 80s.
Yeah, pretty outrageous. Yeah. Cool stuff, pretty amazing. Any talk of working with him more?
Oh man, we would work together in a heartbeat. He's not in the best health.
Ah,
that's the deterrent.
Yeah, that sucks.
Yeah, you know, so when we did that record, when that finally came out, we played like three shows at South By, and he was having so much trouble walking. It turns out he needed a hip replacement.
Oh man,
he had that soon after that trip to Austin, and he's okay. He's just, all I can wish for all of my people that are like him, which there's really nobody like him, but like, you know, all of us that are kind of like in the underground, but like, you know, maybe some people, you know, we hear all the time, like, why aren't you all this shit all the time?
Right, right.
It actually gets really frustrating because it's like, I feel like if some people didn't hear that so much, they would actually be sort of happy with what they've achieved and with like, you know, their sort of lot in life. But you keep hearing like, you should have been, you could have been, why weren't you? And it's like, it's just kind of like,
and you're living the life that you want to live and you're doing the music that you want to do.
Like, I'll speak for myself. Yeah. I have literally never done anything I didn't want to do, except maybe really early on.
Yeah, of course. Then when you got into a groove and you were able to do it, you said you were able to pick and choose.
Yeah, but it's also why I play with other people. But again, I'm not playing with Nickelback. You know,
I wouldn't have you on the show if you didn't. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, I'm playing with, I actually respect, and they're friends.
We shouldn't. I don't like to judge like that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I do that because it's fun, but it's also the only way I make a living.
Yes.
My records don't garner enough income to make a living. Yeah. That's just a fact. And so, you know, there's a, you know, if you're going to do things your own way, you're going to kind of pay in that way. But it's like, for me, it's worth it. But again, you know, I wish everybody that does that was at peace with it.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like you say, when you're getting that phrase thrown at you all the time, it can defeat you. But yeah, if you can come to grips with how we live.
You know, you can get, like, the mob is like, why aren't you? And then you're like, yeah, what they said. Like, why aren't I?
But then you sit back and you go, shit, I'm the luckiest bastard in the world.
So in some ways, yeah. In some ways.
Yep.
You know, I'm still rich. So that's not lucky.
No.
But it's... Yeah.
I wanted to ask you... I want to get into some sessions and stuff now. And this one is just, what was it like that day you got a call to work with Paul McCartney?